I can't see you. Are you ready? Great. Good morning. It's been one of those mornings, you know, so we're just a half step behind, but I'm glad that you're here, and those of you who are watching online are here and worshiping with us this morning. So let us prepare our hearts and minds to worship God.
If you're able, I'd ask you to please stand and join me in the opening prayer. Holy God, let your gentle and patient spirit be in our midst as we gather for worship. Keep the depth of your astonishing mercy and grace ever before us. Help us to praise you and give thanks for all your wonderful ways with us. Now in this hour of worship and each day we live. Amen. And now the praise team will come.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. please stay standing and worship with us. We're going to start off with Build My Life.
You ready? One, two, three, four.
Breath. Out his hand, and the people of the Lord get down to pray. And there's gonna be a brand new song of a victory in this land. And the people of the Lord get down to pray.
Children praying. Oh, listen now. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Oh, Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Send us love. You may be seated. This morning, the scripture comes from Psalms chapter 124. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side when our enemies attacked us, then they would have swallowed us up alive when their anger was kindled against us. Then the flood would have swept us away, the torrent would have gone over us. Then over us would have gone the raging waters. Blessed be the Lord, who has not given us as prey to their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth.
That was not Angie Stokes, that was Carol Bickler. For those of you watching at home. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Oh God, what a perfect song this morning as we implore you to listen to us, your children, pray. That we lift up to you so many that need your presence with them. Your presence of healing, your presence of comfort, presence of courage. We come to worship this morning to pray, to give you all the glory, to thank you for your saving grace and your mercy that has come through Jesus, our Savior. And so, Lord, those who do need your healing touch, we lift them. Those who need that protection from the fires out west, from the volcanoes, from winds and floods, Lord, listen to your children as we pray. And in your mercy, hear us. For all of us, O God, who seek to follow your will, who want to hear from your Holy Spirit as it moves in us and among us this morning, may we be strengthened to truly be salt in the world, to give the world the flavor of your great love, your grace, and your mercy. We thank you. We thank you for the blessings that you pour out upon us. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us as your children to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thine will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now our special music will come from Katie this morning. We had some bronchitis issues flowing through a couple folks in our choir, so we turned to good old Katie. She's always got something in her pocket.
Fall on us.
peace from your hand fall on us, that we
I've said this before, but what a blessing she is. If you're able, please stand for the reading of the gospel. This morning, our reading is from Mark chapter 9, verses 38 through 50. John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if you had a great millstone hung around your neck, and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have two feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." This is the word of God for the people of God.
A few years ago, there was a Mensa convention in San Francisco. Mensa is an organization of members that have really high IQs. I am not a member. But several of the members were lunching at a local cafe, and they like to tell people how smart they are. And while dining, they discovered that their salt shaker contained pepper, and their pepper shaker was full of salt. And the Mensa members, being naturally inquisitive, began to question how they could swap the contents of the two bottles without spilling any of the contents. using only implements at hand. After all, this was clearly a job for the best minds available. And so the group debated, and they presented their ideas to one another, and they finally came up with a brilliant solution involving a napkin, a straw, and an empty saucer. And so they called the waitress to their table, convinced that they would dazzle her with their solution. "Ma'am," they said, "we couldn't help but notice that the pepper shaker contains salt and the salt shaker contains pepper." "Oh," she said, "sorry about that." And without further comment, she unscrewed the caps of both bottles and switched the caps and said, "There, will it be one check or separate?" I guess the Mensa members learned something about the worth of common sense that day. But Jesus described his followers as salt of the earth. In Matthew 5:13, in the Beatitudes, the Sermon on the Mount, "You are the salt of the earth," he says, "but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's not good for anything but to throw underfoot." In Matthew's gospel, these words follow the Beatitudes and are often interpreted as referring to Jesus' expectations of his disciples. So Mark uses the same imagery in today's lesson there in 9:50. He says, "Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again?" Bible scholar William Barclay interpreted Jesus' words like this. He said, "When a thing loses its essential quality and fails to perform its essential duty, it's fit for nothing but to be thrown away." In those days, salt was a really valuable commodity. Salt was valuable for two reasons. It was a preservative for food, and it would enhance the flavor of food. We all know how essential salt is for enhancing the flavor and the taste of food. On some of our most popular and favorite foods, salt really brings out the flavor. You might have heard this story. In 1853, a chef in New York accidentally invented a popular new dish. An annoying patron kept sending his French fried potatoes back to the kitchen because they were soggy. And in an attempt to teach the customer a lesson, Chef Crumb sliced the fries extra thin, fried them to a crisp, drowned them in salt, and to his surprise, the complaining patron actually liked the converted fries, and so potato chips were born. So what would potato chips taste like without salt? Yuck. Or how about French fries or popcorn? Obviously, we can overindulge in salt, but few people voluntarily go on a completely salt-free diet. So when Christ said that we are the salt of the earth, perhaps he was saying that we should bring flavor to life, to the world, as he brought flavor to the life in the world. There was a woman years ago, her name was Marge, and she wrote to Ann Landers. Anybody remember reading Ann Landers in the newspaper? Well, she had a complaint. She said, "I'm 44. I have a swell husband. We get along okay. There's no drinking or gambling or skirt chasing. He has a good job. Our home is paid for. Our children are healthy and normal. They do well in school. The three older ones are teenagers. They've never caused us any problems. And so why am I writing?" she says. "Because my life is blah. Something is missing. My life is like stew without salt. I have a certain emptiness in my life." Anybody identify with that? Many people in our society have that emptiness in their lives. And so like this woman, their lives are blah. Something's missing. And as this woman described her life, it's like stew without salt. So how do we bring flavor to people's lives? How do we do that? Well, Jesus says we do it by showing them genuine concern and love and care. We let them know that somebody cares for them. One Saturday in a small town in Michigan, there was a 5K race. And this race featured different age classes of runners, and there was a 9-year-old boy in the race named Bowden. showing signs of fatigue, and behind him was 19-year-old Marine Lance Corporal Miles Kerr, and he noticed that Boyden was kind of struggling. So Miles offered him some encouragement, and Boyden looked at him and said, "Sir, will you run with me?" And as you know, military folks don't leave their fallen buddies behind. And so even if they're just 9 years old, this Marine ran the rest of that race carrying a full backpack with this 9-year-old boy. Their story was carried out on a Facebook page, Seal of Honor, which added these words. It says, "By his unwavering commitment to help those in need, through his ability to inspire others, by his unequivocal level of motivation, Lance Corporal Miles Kerr reflected a great credit upon himself and was keeping with the highest traditions of the United States Marine Corps." I would like to think that followers of Jesus Christ would also be so kind and helpful to anyone that is struggling as that Marine was. Anytime we show genuine concern for someone else, we're making this world a better place, a more flavorful place. We're adding flavor to their lives. We're showing ourselves to be salt of the earth. I heard about a woman named Martha who was fortunate enough to run into a group of women who most certainly would qualify as salt of the earth. Martha is a 26-year-old woman with ALS, which is sometimes referred to as Lou Gehrig's disease, and she needed help. And this group of women from her town of Evanston, Illinois, heard about Martha and they jumped into action. They began round-the-clock nursing care. They fed her, they bathed her, they prayed for her. Martha couldn't understand how a loving God could let her get ALS, but when she saw God's love in these women, she eventually became a follower of Jesus. Don't you imagine that there was rejoicing in heaven when these women jumped into action to help Martha? Jesus said to his followers that they were the salt of the earth. It was a high compliment. We are to bring flavor to the lives of everyone around us by our genuine concern for others. This is the first thing that salt does. Salt brings flavor to food. But traditionally, however, salt has played an even more important role in the world and in the lives of humans. For many generations, it was the only preservative that humanity had. Indeed, there was, before the modern miracle of refrigeration, people were quite limited in the foods that they could enjoy because they were limited in how they could preserve their food, especially meat. And in his book, Salt for Society, Philip Keller recounts many of his experiences as a youngster growing up in Eastern Africa, and his family lived at the equator under severe tropical conditions. And so there was no refrigeration there while he was growing up. And as a result, his family had no way of preserving meat and fish, fruit, or vegetables. And so like many generations before them, they used salt to preserve their food. Meat in particular would decay rapidly in the heat, as you can imagine. So he recalls how tons and tons of meat were cut up into slender strips that soaked in a salt solution. And then those strips would be hung to dry, becoming what we know today as jerky. Salt was so valuable that soldiers in the Roman Empire received an allowance as part of their pay, a salt allowance, which is the origin of the word salary. In various eras, people in Ethiopia and other parts of Africa have used cakes of salt to pay their debt. That's why you want to make sure that you're worth your salt. When you get paid in salt, you need to be worth your salt. So we simply can't underemphasize how important salt is. The question is, how do we, as followers of Christ, serve as a preservative in our time? Well, the one answer is that we're those who have been entrusted with the task of preserving for future generations the good news of Jesus Christ. We're only one generation away from extinction, folks. That's why this front row is so important. It's the essential task of the people of Jesus Christ to be a witness to his presence in this world. What Jesus wants are witnesses, people who will witness to this generation that Christ is alive and at work in the world. Now, there's a whole lot of ways. When I was in college, I was in Campus Crusade for Christ, and they had a whole different understanding of what witnessing meant. It meant being out on the beach during spring break at Daytona Beach, handing out things and asking people if they knew Jesus, which is totally fine. But what people really want to see is, what did Jesus mean? What does Jesus mean to me? What difference is Jesus going to make in their lives? People will testify to the difference that his presence has made in their lives. People who, because of their credibility, will make it possible to preserve the teachings of Christ for later generations. We each need to ask that question of whether our lives convince people that Christ is alive by the difference he has made in our lives. Are you a witness? Actions speak louder than words, remember that? Of course, you alone can't live up to the ideal, and neither can I, but God already knows this. And God isn't letting us go through this by ourselves. Jesus is with us through the power of the Holy Spirit. God calls and equips and motivates us for ministry. Oh, yeah, ministry. I said ministry. I didn't misspeak there, because we're all to be in ministry. We're all called to be ministers, to witness the love of God in the world. Jesus brings his power and his ability to our limited resources in his limitless ways. So sometimes we sort of fail to see the blessings of the presence of Jesus in our midst. I remember having an ice cream party for kids after a local football game. We came up with a great name, as weird as it was. We set up ice cream, all the trimmings, all the fixing, and we waited with a great anticipation. Finally, several kids came, then a few more, and eventually we might have had 20 kids or so. They seemed to be having fun, so they ate their ice cream and left. Wow. What a waste of time, money, and ice cream, I thought, at the time. We never even got to invite the kids to come back to youth group or to church or anything else. It was pretty evident that we had failed to be good witnesses. I felt terrible. All we did was have a little fun and eat ice cream. Well, I was reminded of a few things that night. God still shows up when you least expect it. Actions speak louder than words. Folks won't always tell you right away how much your actions spoke to them. It takes a little more time for them to evaluate or to think about, especially kids. And I saw some of the kids at the next football game, and they actually did tell me how much fun they had. A few actually said thanks and were surprised that the church would even do that. They thought that was pretty cool. And so did I. Jesus was there working in our midst, and I didn't even see it. We had begun a small relationship with those kids, just a tiny relationship that continued to grow and grow. And we were witnesses of God's love that night. A few years ago, there's a popular book that came out entitled Out of the Salt Shaker and Into the World, Evangelism is a Way of Life by Rebecca Manley Pippert. It's a great book. Jesus says salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? And Rebecca Pippert's thesis is this: salt is good, but if salt stays in the salt shaker, what good is it? How can it flavor life if it stays in the salt shaker? How can it preserve food if it stays in the shaker? How do we get the salt that will change our world out of the salt shaker? Really, there's only one way. And for those of us who follow Jesus, is to live as Christ lived, showing his love for the world to see, because you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? There's only one way for that to happen. That is that each one of us draw close to Christ so that his love radiates through us. You are the salt of the world, Jesus tells us. So this week, go and spill some salt around your world. Show them Jesus. Amen. I'd remind you and thank you for your continued support. The offering plates are in the back of the church. We're still not passing those around, but you can continue to support us in that way, and we just want to tell you that we appreciate it and we love you for it. Our closing hymn, if you'll stand as Katie goes to the organ and sing with us, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." You follow along in the hymnal, it's page 400. You are the salt of the earth. Go spread around some salt this week. May God our Creator, Jesus our Savior, and the Holy Spirit our comfort and guide be with us now and always. Amen.